Hello, thank you for coming. My name is Int80. I'm the rapper in a group called Dual Core, or you can call me by my nickname, which is Staff. This is me on Twitter, if you want to follow me or tweet things about rap music at me. And then I made this talk with a friend of mine, Savant. This is him. He's in California, so he couldn't be here. I'm very happy to be back to RoadSec. I was here last year. I really loved it, so thank you again for having me. Standard disclaimer, go break laws. Do whatever you want to do. This is me. I'm the rapper in Dual Core. I like computers. I am a professional by my paycheck, but really I just like mash on my keyboard and see what happens, and sometimes fun things happen. This is Savant. He's way smarter than I am. Again, he couldn't be here today. Also, I hope you guys like Rick and Morty. So this talk is called Full Contact Recon, and we're gonna kind of run through, we're gonna start at the end with like the final like main bullet point, and then we're gonna run through like a hypothetical offensive operation. And then we'll talk about how we do things running our like offensive operations. So the whole premise of all of this is that if you're doing like a pen test or like a red team operation, you can front load the operation with recon. You can get so much information about your target without ever touching your target. By the time that you make a connection into your target's infrastructure, you'll have an access, like a shell with root privileges or system privileges. So the whole point is to like send as little traffic to your target first, or send as little traffic to your target, because each time you send traffic to your target, you have a risk of getting caught. So we're gonna talk about ways that we kind of build out recon in our operation. So this is our conclusion. Hackers, pen testers, take the easiest route, right? Like, I'm lazy. I don't have time to like look at everything, so I just go for what I think is gonna be the fastest win. So you can also do this, repeat these same steps, and find very good attack surface in your organization or in your targets that you're looking at. So you can use full contact recon to basically win an engagement before it even starts. So we're gonna talk about, we're gonna delineate here between what a red team operation is, a pen test, and a vulnerability assessment. So starting with pretenditration testing, right? Kind of like penetration testing, but not really. This is more like a vuln scan. You're running something like Nessus or Qualys, and you're just finding vulnerabilities that need to be patched. But you're not really fixing issues, maybe. You're not identifying maybe like issues with like processes or workflows or more complex systems that are in place. So you're generally handcuffed. Maybe you have like a really short time to do this, like one day or a week. You don't get to do things like physical break-ins or like social engineering. So in this case, you're doing almost no recon. You're just basically hitting scan and run. Skirmish, this is more of what I think of as like a penetration test, right? Like you're saying like, can I prove an objective out? We use the term like kill chain accelerator as like scenario based, right? Like if I have a shell on this system, can I get access to this data over here in the production environment? And you're basically trying to prove out a particular kill chain. There's some recon going on here, but it's still like you already have access. You're starting with some kind of access. And then yellow scope, this is what I do. We do red team stuff, so we literally start with nothing. We are external adversaries. We figure out how to get in, how to get stuff, and then how to get out. And this is where recon is really, really important, because it's all about not getting caught. Okay, so what is full contact recon? Well, basically, we are using this idea that we want to get as much information as we can using other platforms and services out on the internet without touching our target infrastructure. We have this idea of packet economics. Every packet that you send in your target infrastructure is a chance for getting detected. And we're literally trying to not get detected, steal things, get in, get out. So if you're sending packets out on the internet, right, like if you run like an Nmap scan, or you're like using Burp to like look at a target's website, pretty low risk of getting caught, right? You can move infrastructure around. The internet scans itself regularly, so you're probably not making too much noise. It's going to get you specifically caught. Now, like if you've already gotten an access or a foothold inside of the environment and you're scanning or moving around there, higher chance of detection, right? Like there should be fewer people in the corporate network than like out on the internet. And then as you move into the production environment where like your customer data or like your secrets that you're going after might be stored, there should be even fewer people in that production environment, meaning like any traffic that you send is more likely to stand out as you as an attacker. So why not use exploits? All of this is done without using any exploits at all. And there are several reasons. First off, like memory corruption can be bad, right? Everybody here knows Eternal Blue, the exploit that came out of the NSA's leaks. The original name for that exploit was Eternal Blue Screen because it would crash systems so frequently. It was very unreliable. So you don't want to crash systems that you're targeting. This ties in with higher risk of denial of service. If a box goes offline, why is this service offline? Or why is the box offline? You might get investigation going, looking into why the system went down. Also, like when you're using exploits, people write signatures for exploits, right? So you might trigger detection with an IDS or an antivirus. And for us to not use exploits is because we've been successful without using them. We don't need exploits, so we don't bother. Okay, so this is generally what it comes down to. Find the systems that have the data that you want. Find the people who have access to those systems. Find the credentials that are used by those people. And then get the actual stuff. Again, all without getting caught. So this is a quick story about a red team operation that we ran and how our idea of full contact recon started. So we had a target company, and we wanted to break into them. And Savant was at home. The rest of us were at DEF CON partying, drinking all the booze, hacking all the things. And Savant says, I'll start recon against this target. We'll see how it goes. So he goes on LinkedIn. He's like, who are the employees at this company? Oh, this guy is an IT administrator. Okay, let me like look up, is he in the LinkedIn database dump by chance? Oh, he is. Okay, let me crack his password real fast. Oh, neat. Cracked his password. Then we looked up, or Savant looked up on Shodan, said like, is there somewhere I can SSH into this company? And sure enough, like on Shodan, here's a system that has SSH open. So Savant says, okay, let me just try this guy's work email address, like username, and his LinkedIn password. And it worked. And because the guy is an IT admin, he has root everywhere. And so Savant literally like ended the operation before any of us could jump in to like work on it. And we're all at DEF CON still drinking all the booze and hacking all the things. It was like 2 minutes and done. So that's how powerful full contact recon can be. Okay, so this is a hypothetical red team operation that we're going to run. Dirty Rick desperately wants to get his hands on the DNA of the one true Morty. The Council of Ricks stores this DNA in a highly secured database on Earth C-137. Dirty Rick wants to hire Hacker Rick to retrieve the data. Does anybody here watch Rick and Morty? My people. So here's Hacker Rick. We're going to call the operation the Whirly Derby Conspiracy. Hacker Rick does some brief recon while he's thinking about taking this operation. After some research, Hacker Rick realizes the database is being hosted by Citadel operatives deep within NASA on Earth C-137. Hacker Rick consults Savant's totes legit matrix of prone probability and decides to take the gig. What is Savant's totes legit matrix of prone probability, you might ask? Well, it's this, a very official graph that we made. Basically, what we've anecdotally seen is that as the age of an organization increases, as they get older, and their number of users grows, so their employee size grows, you have a higher likelihood of owning them. There's like systems that people set up and forget about. There's technical debt that's incurred. Maybe the company has acquisitions that have completely different tech stacks that are being migrated in. There's like all these different ways to win. So first off, let's talk about finding systems, right? Okay, we want to find IP addresses for, in this case, NASA being the North American Space Agency, right? They launch rockets and put people on the moon and send people into outer space. So they're way smarter than I am. So, like, why not hack them and get their secrets? Also, please don't hack them. I want to keep sending people into outer space. Okay, everybody knows IP addresses, right? So AS numbers. AS numbers are the hierarchy for how IP addresses are allocated geographically across the planet. So if we want to get IP addresses for an organization, we can literally download this database, decompress it, use some bash, and then pull out IP addresses for the organization. So here we are pulling out or downloading the database, extracting it, and then when we grep for NASA, we get a bunch of IP addresses. So now we have systems that we can look at. PTR archive. This has a bunch of DNS records dating back to 2008, so almost about 10 years worth of DNS on the internet. You can search it by an IP address, an IP range, and also just an organization name. So in this screenshot, you can see we've put in an IP address. We've also put in NASA. And here are the results. We get some NASA hosts. There's a NASA.gov host, some more NASA hosts. So cool. Again, both with PTR archive and the AS numbers, we didn't touch NASA, right? We still haven't sent any packets to NASA. Google Certificate Transparency Report. So another data source you can access for free. Google basically archives a bunch of certificate data, and then you can just search it. So these are certs that are used by NASA. And again, we're getting more host names, right? Add.nasa.gov, cce.nasa.gov. Sublister, free tool. You can use it to look up domains. So we use Sublister and we say, tell me all the domain names you can find for NASA.gov. So we'll get a bunch of subdomains out of that, right? So Sublister goes out to Baidu, it goes out to Yahoo, it goes out to Google, it goes out to Bing, all these other platforms, right? None of these are NASA. In the end, we get 1,100 hosts. Now we have 1,100 targets at NASA, all without having sent any traffic to NASA. So at this point, NASA doesn't even know that we're checking their stuff out. Shodan, I mentioned Shodan earlier. Shodan's awesome. Anybody here use Shodan? My people. So great, like you can put in IP addresses, you can look for services, you can put in names. So when we look up NASA, we see 350 results. We get HTTP headers, science.nasa.gov. This looks like FTP. Yeah, there you go. NASA HQ, anonymous FTP server, right? But again, we still haven't talked to NASA yet. Still zero packets sent to NASA. So we found a bunch of systems. Now let's find the people that have access to those systems. So when we first start operations, one thing that we do is we go and look up, like, who are the people that work at this company that probably have access to the data that I want? So in a lot of cases, you know, we're after like customer data, which is going to be stored in some kind of data store, like a back-end database. And so usually people interact with that are like database engineers or software developers, stuff like that. So GitHub is an amazing platform for developers and engineers. One thing that's awesome is every time you make a commit and your commit goes into GitHub, there's an email address associated with that. So I wrote a tool that programmatically can scrape email addresses out of a person's GitHub repo or an organization's GitHub repo. So if you want to do this manually, this is an example like manually, you can git clone the repo, and then you can run git log, grep for the author, and then do some regular expressions to pull out email addresses. So this is my anti-forensics repo off of GitHub, and we see this si at securitysense.co.uk. We see this xcdx80 at gmail.com. That's my email address. Int 80. But that's doing it manually, right? So what if we want to do it programmatically? And that was only for one repo, right? I have like a bunch of repos on my GitHub. NASA has like a bazillion repos on their GitHub. So this is GitHub. I wasn't sure how the internet connection was going to be here, but what you do is we go to like NASA's GitHub, right? And we could scrape all of the commits to all of the repos for NASA. What I did was I picked a random person here who's a contributor. So I picked this guy, A. Frank Leon. So I take his username, A. Frank Leon. I pass it into GitHub here. GitHub goes out to GitHub, and it pulls each repo that this user or this organization has. So here we find 107 email addresses in this repo. We find 8 email addresses. And in the end, we take the unique email addresses out of all of those, and we store them in this file. So let's see if we got any NASA email addresses from GitHub. So here we just use grep, and we're just going to look for NASA. Cool. So now I have email addresses of NASA employees, which I can then use to probably assert usernames and email address format for employees at NASA. So if I want to try logging into systems later on, I have at least some people to look up. Again, all of these only through GitHub, still no packets sent to NASA. NASA has no idea that we're doing this. The code for GitHub is written in Bash, pretty easy. It's on my GitHub, so feel free to clone it, make modifications, send me pull requests, happy to add in new features. Really basic stuff. This is just usage, welcome message. So the reason this works is because GitHub has an API that you can interact with. So we use curl to go out, make a RESTful API request. We're actually requesting all of the repositories for the target. Then we're pulling out, using some bash to pull out the names. And then for each repository, we clone it. And then for each commit in the repository, we pull out the author information. Take all of those author records out, take the email addresses out of those, and now we have a bunch of email addresses and a bunch of authors. So this is cool, right? Like, we get two pieces of useful information. We get people that are probably contributors to like some kind of like development or engineering efforts at NASA. So that means they might have access, or they likely have access to like data that we want. And we have their email addresses, which we can then use to look up in database dumps later to then go on and get credentials. Again, I apologize, I'm sick, I have a cold. Another win here is tying in GitHub with whatever automation you might have in place. So on my red team, we have a Slack bot, and we wired up GitHub to the Slack bot. So in the chat in Slack, I can just say, bang, GitHub, and like int 80. And it will like go and get me like all of the people it can find. But I don't even have to run the tool by myself. I just, in Slack, it works. Also, gists are awesome. Anybody use gists on GitHub? Like, you just have a code snippet that you just post up quickly? Yeah. Lots of cool details you can find in gists. And we'll come back to that later. All right, another platform we can use, this kind of like GitHub, is Travis CI. Anybody use or know Travis CI? Awesome. Continuous integration. Basically, you can push code, build it, and just keep rolling. But it's a public-facing data source, right? So there's travisci.org, which we can then access programmatically and get usernames and email addresses out of. So I wrote this tool called TCI Spy, Travis CI Spy. It uses a Travis Pi Python module, and then it can get you data. So again, I wasn't sure on the internet situation here, so I ran this at my hotel where I had Wi-Fi. And so this is the full workflow. You just clone the repo. I use make virtual environment, trying to keep my Python packages somewhat clean. Pip install the Travis Pi Python module. And then you simply run the TCI Spy script and give it a target to scrape. So we got this by going to travisci.org/NASA. And then these are projects that we can target to get information out of. So I found this EDSC Echo Forums has 157 commits. So I went with that. Now you'll also notice there's this like MD5 sum or SHA-1 at the back of it. That's actually an API key that you'll need to generate on your personal GitHub account. It's free to do. You just give it certain permissions, which are documented in the TCI SPI code or the GitHub README. So it's really easy to set up. But once you have your API key set up from GitHub, you can start making programmatic queries to Travis CI and start getting information. So when we queried this EDSC Echo Forums project, we ended up getting some names and email addresses back. So we actually, this one looks familiar because we saw him over here, right? So that's kind of cool. The other thing that's neat about this is we're going to be looking up these email addresses in database dumps moving forward. What if I didn't sign up for, what if I work at NASA and I signed up for LinkedIn, but I didn't sign up with my NASA.gov email address, right? If all I've got is NASA.gov email addresses, I'm going to be missing some NASA employees looking through database dumps. But look, we've also got this guy's personal email address. So now we can grep for both his personal and his work email address across all the database dumps. So what our goal is to acquire as many email addresses as we can for every single person that we think might have access to the data that we want. And then taking those email addresses and searching all the database dumps we've aggregated, looking for hashes that we can then translate into clear text passwords. And then TCI SPI written in Python, also pretty straightforward because I'm not an amazing developer, so I just write simple things. Again, these are the arguments, the repo that you want to target, and then the token that you have. These are the permissions that your GitHub token will need. And then we're just using the Travis Pi Python module and literally looping over every single build and pulling out the author name and email. And dump. And that's it. It's pretty simple. Another good place to find people that you can target is data.com. Anybody use data.com? Nice. You can literally just put in a company name and say, like, who are the employees at this company? And it will be like, here are all the employees. Works really well. So this is using data.com to look up a particular company. And here we've got a bunch of names, their title, their location. The thing that's kind of funny about data.com, and I don't condone using it this way, but I may or may not know people that use it this way, is data.com gives you credits. So you use credits, like note here, I have 10 points, right? As you like pull out more information, you spend points. But what you can do is dump a bunch of information out of a company, load it into data.com, and get more points, which you can then use to spend to get more people to hack. It's a good cycle that feeds itself. I don't condone doing that, but you can use the platform that way. Hunter.io, awesome site. You can look up stuff, domain names, and then it will give you back email addresses that it knows for those domain names. This is good also. It gives you like email address format as well as actual accounts. It's free to sign up, and so if you actually log in with a free account, it won't obfuscate the email address, so you'll actually just get it plain. Again, all of this, like, we still haven't touched NASA.gov yet. Zero packets to NASA.gov. NASA.gov has no idea that we're looking into them. I mean, look at this, 9,000 email addresses. It's great. Okay, so now we saw, like, Bo's son previously, right? But we don't know, is Bo's son still an employee at NASA? It would look really weird if we were trying to access Bo's son's NASA account and he like doesn't work there anymore. That to me is like a red flag. So how can we check if Bo's son is still employed by NASA? We can connect to their SMTP server and try to send him an email. And if we don't get a bounce back, we're good to go. So Hunter.io can do this. Verify-email.org can do this. But I will point out that here, at this point, we are actually making a connection to NASA.gov. Right? If you notice here, we've looked up the MX record for NASA.gov, which may or may not hit their DNS servers. But here, we've made a connection into their mail server. So now we've actually sent packets to NASA. But all we're doing is setting up the mail. And in SMTP, you can do this with receipt too. You can do it with verify. And I think there's like one other primitive in SMTP that will just ask, like, is this email account still valid? And then that's it. The connection closes after that. And we actually don't send an email. So if you're a blue teamer and you're on defense, you might want to look and see, like, is somebody like opening a connection for SMTP, checking an email address, and then closing the connection without sending a mail? And that might be people that you want to more closely monitor their activity on your network. Twitter. We all use Twitter. There's a plugin called All My Tweets. It just uses the Twitter API. But it basically aggregates all the tweets for a target account. In this case, this is my account, Dual Core Music. And I was looking for my email address in all of my tweets. So I've, you know, written on Twitter, like, yeah, send me an email, dualcoremusic@gmail.com, right? So I can, like, take that, like, a Frank Leone guy or any other NASA employees, go through all their tweets, look up, use a regex, look up email addresses that they've tweeted previously, pull all those out. Now I have more email addresses for the individual user. LinkedIn, we all know, like, it's great to stalk people on LinkedIn. But did you know that if you have the LinkedIn dump, you can get email addresses from a user's LinkedIn profile? Cool. I'll show you how to do it. So we go and look up somebody on LinkedIn. We get their unique ID, like their user ID from LinkedIn. And then we looked it up in the LinkedIn dump, and we get their associated email address. This is my LinkedIn profile, David Hacks. If we do view source on that, we'll get something like this, like this long number. And we could take that long number, that unique ID, and look through the LinkedIn dump and get an email address back. You can also do this for entire organizations. So if we go and look up NASA on LinkedIn, there's 19,000 employees. It would be nice to have 19,000 employee emails for NASA. All for free, right? LinkedIn, we haven't touched the NASA infrastructure in doing this recon. So when you run this, running against JPL, NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratories. These are some IDs that we get. And when we look up those IDs in the LinkedIn dump, we get these NASA.gov email addresses. We also get what look like unsalted SHA-1 hashes. And that's what those are. So now we've got a bunch of hashes from all of our database dumps. We've taken all the email addresses we've collected. We've run them across all the database dumps we've aggregated. We've got all these hashes. Let's get them into clear text creds. So at work, we had some money that we spent on a Brutalis rig from Sagita or TerraHash. It's got like, I don't know, 6 graphics cards in it or 8 graphics cards or whatever, and just like cracks hashes really fast. But if you don't have that kind of money, you can still translate hashes very quickly on the cheap. So there's insidepro.com, and they have this lookup, finder.insidepro, and you just dump hashes into it. And you get creds. So we literally just got 167 creds for free, not having touched NASA. Also, just Google, right? Google a hash, and you can find the clear text translation for it if Google already knows about it. Free internet rainbow tables. So I know that there are multiple like versions of the LinkedIn dump. I think the last statistic I've seen is like maybe 96 or 98% of the creds in the LinkedIn dump have been cracked at this point. So grabbing through our copy of cracked creds from the LinkedIn dump, we get 1,628 credentials for NASA employees, all for free without having touched NASA yet. Okay, so we've got a bunch of users that probably have access to good stuff. We've got a bunch of hosts to look at, and we've got a bunch of credentials for those users. So we've got the systems, the people, and their creds. So how should we start using them? Well, one of my favorite things to look at is wikis. So much information in wikis, right? So going back to when we were doing our system enumeration, our system recon, we found these wikis. So we're like, okay, let's try to log in with some creds into the wiki. And if you can log in, you can get a lot of awesome information. I mentioned GitHub gist earlier. I had an operation where a developer had left an S3 bucket URL in a gist of his on GitHub, and I was able to just browse that S3 bucket and pull down all of the backups that were in the S3 bucket. You can Google Dork to find S3 buckets, but man, like, gists are just like for the win all the way. So the backups that I pulled down out of S3 were Duplicity. Has anybody seen Duplicity? I hadn't seen it before. This was new to me. It's a backup utility. It's free, but it's basically like doing rsync with GPG. It's kind of rad. You get encryption plus like incremental backups. You basically end up with this like encrypted like archive, like a tar volume, like uploaded into the cloud. And I think Duplicity can talk to like a lot of different storage platforms, but a lot of people seem to use it with S3. So here I am using the AWS command line tool, pulling backups from this Puppet server, and then using Duplicity to like decompress the backups. But there's one thing that looks weird in this screenshot. No encryption. So by default, Duplicity uses GPG, so I would need the secrets, the passphrase, or keys to be able to decrypt and then decompress these backups. But because in this operation, the target did not use encryption, I get all the secrets for free. So here I pulled a bunch of SSH keys out of their backups and then was able to use this SSH key to SSH into their environment and move around. And guess what? Everything's completely owned. This screenshot is from they had a web application that had authentication mechanism in it. So I backdoored the source code on that web app, and then I was able to just dump creds out every time an engineer or a developer logged in. So this is like one of the sets of creds that I was able to pull out. So end game, we're using our secrets that we've looted, and we now have the source code for the one true Morty. So again, full contact recon, finding the systems, finding the people that use the systems, and then finding their creds without sending traffic to the target infrastructure. And then once you connect, you have a shell, you have access that's privileged, and you're good to go. You get root everywhere. So again, hackers are lazy, right? Like, all I did was look some stuff up on the internet, and then bam, own the organization. So take these steps, go back to work, try them against your organization. Like, rotate creds, lock down services, make people put 2FA everywhere. Like, MFA would make this like way harder, multi-factor authentication. But you can use these steps, whether you're a red team or a blue team, to help improve the security at your organization. Obrigado. Any questions? We'll be right back.